everyone, welcome to the GRE how-to series where we make studying for the GRE a lot more tolerable. I have news. I am going to take the GRE for the very last time tomorrow. And there are a couple of things that I really hope that I remember on test day. So I'm going to share them with you and let me know if there's anything that I should be keeping in mind as well. Stay tuned. Hello there, you heard right, I am taking the GRE for the last and final time. This is it. If I don't make it and I don't get it anywhere, that is fine. I have another path waiting for me. That is basically my mentality at the moment. That said, you know, I'm gonna do this again, and I actually want to make sure that I at least put my best foot forward. I mean, I do think that scheduling a month after my second time is not enough time. So if you do plan on retaking the GRE, by all means do so, but you really want to make sure you're minding the deadlines of your programs, because I don't think 1 month or the 21 days, which is the minimum amount of time that you'd have to wait in order to take it again, is enough time. You know, I think that, you know, in a perfect world, 3 more months would have been great. But at the same time, I know me. And the way my life is right now, I would have had a, you know, difficult client or a very difficult travel schedule, and life would happen, and I probably would have wasted the 3 months also. So I think the best thing to do is, you know, quit your job and dedicate your entire life to studying for the GRE. However, that is not feasible. And I was kidding. I don't think that that is the way to go. But what I do think is that if you are a current student right now, take advantage of this time. Because when you cross the threshold into adulthood, real life, real job, and everything, then you really surrender your time. And it's just really hard to take control of your schedule. Now, some of you may be working full-time jobs while in school as well. And yes, I know that's really hard, but I do think that at the end of the day, if you're still a student, just take the time to prioritize studying while you have as few distractions as possible. If that's not your life story, that's okay. All you need to do is make sure that you give yourself enough time and make sure that you are making sure that you're disciplined enough to do what you need to do in the allotted time. What I don't want you to do is underestimate how much time it's going to take for you to get ready for this test. I want you all to achieve your dreams. So I'm just gonna give you a little real talk. Fact of the matter is, I think I had my best study time right after graduation, before I started a full-time job. Ever since I started a full-time job, it's been much harder for me to be consistent with my study. But maybe you're better than me. But, you know, my two cents. Anyway, that's my rant of love for you guys, because, I mean, I feel really strongly about this. I think that, you know, soapbox alert, but this is a standardized test and its main audience is people who come from unstandardized backgrounds. So, I mean, it's not going to be the best measurement of your capacity, but it is a measurement of capacity that a lot of schools take. Therefore, it's really important to kind of take that seriously and just do your best. You know, I try to take admissions people at their word when they say that a GRE or a GMAT score isn't going to be the main determinant of your admission. So I think that you always want to be in the ball game. I don't think that that's a pass for severely underperforming, but what I do think is that if you put your best foot forward and you do everything that you need to do in order to show perseverance and show grit, and you make sure that all other parts of your story and your application are tight, impressive, and you know what the admissions teams are looking for, then you are at least best positioning yourself within your circumstances. And that is all that we can really hope for, I think. So just keep going. You'll get there. All right, moving on. As promised, I really want to share the 5 things that I hope I remember come test day. These are really critical things that are going to help you in a lot of the journey. It's mostly quant focused, so if you don't struggle with the quantitative part, great for you. That is awesome. That's not my story. So I am going to talk about mostly the things I hope I remember for the quant side. If you're more interested in my verbal videos, click up here and I will have them ready for you. One thing before I get started is I coined a couple nicknames for the things that I hope I remember to help me remember what they are. So if they are weird, then hey, think of your own nicknames and let me know in the comments below how you are going to remember some of these things. So number 5, I call triangulate. And what I mean by that is I really hope I remember the lengths of the 90 degree triangles. There's the 30, 60, 90 degree triangle and the 45, 45, 90 degree triangle. And okay, here's the test. All right, so when you're looking at the triangle, this is the 90 degree. Okay, so the angle with the longest, this is my best 90 degree triangle, and we'll know that the hypotenuse is opposite of the largest angle, so that one's going to be 2x, and then there's x, which is the bottom one, and this one is x times the square root of 3. So if I remember that, that might come in handy when I'm trying to really untangle a really hairy problem and I get to the point where I can actually isolate the what would probably be the x and I can fill in the blanks. 45, 45, 90 degree triangle is pretty easy. The two sides with the equal angles are equal, they equal x, and then the hypotenuse, if I remember correctly, is x times the square root of 2. Let me look at my notes, use a study pack to make sure I'm right, because, you know, that's why I have this thing. I keep track of my notes and booyah, x radical 2 is the answer. This has seen some things, if you can tell. It's my trusty study system that has served me well, and I will no longer need you. No offense. Hey, it actually might come in handy to stay organized. Number 4 is what I call conjunction function. And by that, I mean, I really want to make sure that I'm remembering the dual purposes of the words and or. Really, when you see and, when it's a probability or combinatorics problem, then it's most likely that you're going to need to multiply in order to find your outcomes. Now, when you see or, that is going to most likely mean you're going to need to add to find out the number of outcomes. I think that that's something that's going to be really important, because as I was brushing up on my combinations and permutation problems and then a little bit of probability, I realized that, hey, those are some powerful 2 and 3 letter words that mean something that's going to help me move me forward in order to get the right answer. So I really hope I remember that. Number 3 is what I call the square dance. And by that, I mean the difference of squares. It's just really interesting, as I was practicing this third time around, how many ways you can really disguise the difference of squares, whether it's x plus y squared, x minus y squared, or x squared minus y squared. Here's one thing. I've always, whenever I saw the difference of squares formula, it's all foiled out, I've seen it as like the x squared and then 2xy and then y squared. What I never noticed before is that it doesn't matter if it's x plus y squared or x minus y squared. The x squared and the y squared are always positive. I never noticed that. I don't know why. I just never noticed that. And I don't know why it blew my mind when I saw it. But it's actually really helpful because I know that no matter what, if it's an x plus y squared, x plus y in parentheses squared, or x minus y squared, then that means that it's x squared plus y squared. And then if there's a plus in the parentheses, then it's plus 2xy. And if there's a minus in the parentheses, then it's minus 2xy. Say what? That's something that I really hope I remember on test day because it's going to help me save a lot of time when it comes to multiplying things out and trying to stay organized. The more you try to do a lot of those scratch work, the more likely, at least for me, that I'll get disorganized and confused, and that's no bueno. So I hope I remember that. Now, when it comes to x squared minus y squared, I just hope I remember that that can show itself in a lot of different ways. What if you saw 3 to the 30th power minus 2 to the 30th power? You know, that is actually 3 to the 15th power squared minus 2 to the 15th power squared. And you can actually do the x plus y, x minus y in order to solve that much quicker. Try it out. I promise it works. That's something I really hope I keep in mind and test it because I do know that differences of squares sneak up on you in some really, really funky ways. Number two is what I call CrossFit, and hopefully Reebok doesn't sue me for it because I just really hope that I remember that no matter what, there are some really cool tools that I can actually deploy, such as cross multiplication. Whenever I see, let's say, fractions on the opposite side of an equal sign, I know that I can cross multiply to try to find an easier answer. Also, I think that cross examination also fits when it comes to quantitative comparison. Oftentimes, I always look at the column A and column B in isolation, and I've been really trying to practice looking across to cancel out like terms, to try to isolate the variable a little bit more so that I can make the quantitative comparison a lot more clear. So I really hope that I remember CrossFit, lifting heavy things, cross-examination, cross-multiplication when it comes to test day, because I think that's gonna help me a lot when it comes to those moments that I've experienced twice now where I'm just looking at it and I'm just like, I don't know. So CrossFit, that's what I hope I remember. And number one, the number one thing I hope I remember, I call test drive. And what I mean by that is try not to always get too bogged down with all of the math and start to kind of set up the problems in a way where I can actually plug in the answers to test the answers to see what is actually going to work. I've heard really good strategy of starting with the second one and the fourth one because oftentimes the answer choices are in actual ascending order, as in the lowest is first and the largest one is last. So if you start with the second one and you see that your answer is a wee bit too high, boom, you can automatically choose the first one and move on. And the same goes the other way around. So that is something that I learned, and I hope that, you know, I think there's all the time where I'm like actually working on these problems, I often want to finish it and see it to the end, but there is a timed component to the test. Trust me, if this was a timeless test, I probably could blow it out of the water. Those are the five things I really hope I remember tomorrow when I take the test. And hey, are there any other things that you hope you remember when you take the test? Let me know in the comments below and I will be sure to share any tips, or I can have fun with you and we can name them together: CrossFit, Triangulate, Test Drive. I have more fun doing that than actually studying. So lucky for me, it actually helps me when I study. If this video was helpful for you, give me a thumbs up. Please let me know what you liked about this video. Please share it with your friends if you found it valuable. And thank you so much for allowing me to make a small contribution toward your success. I'll see you next time.